judgment will not stand. Not the sinners in the assembly are the righteous. For God watches over the way of godly men, but the way of the world, their way will
I have a few announcements for you. At both the gatherings next Sunday, there will be carols and readings. That will be the format. On Christmas Day, that service will be here, 9:30, just the one service only. And that service will also be Zoomed. There will be no Sunday service on the 27th of December. That's only a couple of days later. We've decided to not do that with the closeness of Christmas Day being so close. But also the morning tea on Tuesday morning here in the 15th, that's a couple of days time. At the moment, it's on. And hopefully there's pennies from heaven and the rain will have eased off. And come Tuesday morning, we'll all be able to get out without much problem. And how much are these? $12. And there's eight of these left. So if you'd like a Christmas we didn't expect, there are 12 of those left. I think that's it. Thanks, guys. There's a clip now from APWN.
Brothers and sisters, I'd like to give you just a quick update on what's been happening in the APWM world over the last few months. Many of you will know that in about July, we received word that the 9,000 New Air Bibles that we had sent had finally arrived in the refugee camps in Western Ethiopia. At the time, we had to hold some money in reserve. That money is now free for us to be able to use. We've received further donations, and so we're looking to put a second order in late January, maybe early February next year. So if you'd like to contribute towards that second order, please do so. We'd love more support for that particular project. So please try and do that by the 1st of January. That would be fantastic. Christmas catalogue. Many of you will know that we sell Christmas gifts at Christmas. But they're not socks and the regular things that you receive at Christmas. These are cards where you give, for example, training for pastors in Timor-Leste. And the money that you give as the gift helps to fund a small Australian team to go across and run a week's training there. Or helping with the prisons in Malawi, which are just horrendous places to be. I've visited them and you would not want to spend more than a few hours there. So have a look at our catalogue and see if you can help in that way this Christmas. Thank you very much also to those that gave towards our Indigenous Ministry Sunday appeal. We received about $23,000 and we're very grateful for the gifts that were given as part of that project. We're going to divide that now. Half of it will go to the work that Alvin and Narelle Chai are doing at Mount Magnet, with an Indigenous population there of about 85%, and the other half will go towards the support of Rick and Kaylin Manton as they serve at Mount Druitt here in Sydney, but also further afield in helping to train and resource Aboriginal leaders. Thank you also to those that have given towards the rebuilding of the Talua Ministry Training Centre in Vanuatu following Cyclone Harold. It's a thrill to see that work commence. And it's so encouraging to know that the college is on track to reopen in May 2021. And so those of you that gave, you have made a tangible difference in the strategic life of the church and the work of the gospel in the South Pacific and in Vanuatu in particular. So thank you very much. And finally, as part of that, we are sending Rob and Earl Falls to work with the Talua Ministry Training Centre in 2021. Obviously, they're still in Australia because of COVID. And so for the first 6 months, Rob is going to be doing remote curriculum development work in Australia 2 days a week. If you'd like to be supporting them next year, when they finally get to the field in July, we hope, please get in touch. We'd love to be able to assist you, partner with them in that regard. Thank you also for your ongoing prayers and support. We really do appreciate it. Thanks.
There we go. Dave's now going to pray for us. Thanks, Dave.
His voice is coming out of the wall. Good morning, one and all. Let's have a time of, let's come to the, before the Lord in a word of prayer. Lord, we come to you as your people, humbling ourselves before the creator of this perfect universe that you created. Yes, Lord, us, the people who are destroying it. But we know, Lord, that you love us, but we know that your love for us is great. And your love is so great that you sent your only Son to us to show us the way to your Father, and by dying on a cross and bearing our sin and shame so that we could stand blameless before you. Lord, I pray that you would forgive us and that you would treat us not as we deserve. Lord, I pray that you would bless the work of APMW, and particularly I pray for those that received the Bibles in Ethiopia back in July, and that you would also, that these Bibles would bring to these people your very light and your very hope in a world that to them must seem so devastating. And Lord, also for this next shipment, I just pray too, Lord, that you would give it safe passage and that it would be distributed without hindrance. Lord, I would also pray for those that labour in the missionary field that are being supported by APMW. We pray for places like Vanuatu, Timor and Western Australia. I just thank you, Lord, for the hearts these people have in proclaiming you and being an encouragement to those in the communities they work and are ministering to. Lord, in a year that where there's been so much insecurity and disruption, I give thanks to the security and assurance we have in you. And as this year comes to an end, I give thanks for the work that has gone on in this year, scripture that has been allowed to resume, and the wonderful dedication of these teachers in teaching and bringing your life and your word to them. In particular, Lord, I give thanks to Yvonne McGrath, who has dedicated so many years to present you in a pure light to a young world just starting life. Lord, I would also give thanks for the mainly music team, the growth groups, the youth leaders, the Sunday school teachers. Lord, as a family, as we all come together and we all do our little bit, Lord, I pray that it is a great thing for you in this community, Lord, and that through that outreach work that your name will be proclaimed and glorified. Lord, all these leaders have been an encouragement to us, and I would just pray, Lord, that we may be an encouragement to them. And I pray that as this year ends, they may be well rested and strengthened in you. Lord, I also give thanks to our elders who have also provided leadership, unity, and more importantly, keep us faithful to you. I'd also give thanks to Stephen Biati, and Lord, I'd pray that you would keep them in good health so that they can continue the work that you have called them to do, and that also that the work that you have destined for them to do in us in 2021. And in all these things, I give you thanks, Lord. Amen.
Thanks, Dave. Charles Wesley and a few of his mates gave us this carol, and that needs absolutely no introduction at all. Thanks, guys.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn.
mercy, my God, as sinners reconciled, joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born.
Good morning, everyone. Officially, we are told that we can sing indoors, but if you're over 12, you need to wear a mask. Okay. And I'm looking around here and I'm thinking, I don't see any 12-year-olds. I sent that through email, but look, next week, or the services next week, there are carols and readings, and I don't know what changes can change daily, can change weekly, but I'm just telling you the official line, okay? You want to sing along, that's fine. Watch the p-p sound though, because that's quite offensive in COVID days. Friends, also, I just wanted to start by saying thank you, because the session actually had agreed to just free me up a bit from time to time so I can get my head straight again and get into things. So this today, there is, as Phil said, there's a video Bible talk by Simon Manchester. And it was just nice that this week I just concentrated on the Christmas sermons. So next week we're looking at the Christmas hope, ... vaccine, ? And then on Christmas Day, we're looking at what if? What if our Saviour was a man? Does our Saviour have to be a man? What if the Creator came and became part of creation So I'm just going to play with that a bit. And look why that's integral to our understanding of what God has done in Jesus for our salvation. So there are two things we're looking at. This particular parable, the persistent widow, it's in Luke chapter 18, just reading the first eight verses. And it's a difficult parable to understand. That's why we asked Simon to come today and help us. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. He said, "In a certain town, there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with the plea, 'Grant me justice against my adversary.' For some time he refused, but finally he said to himself, 'Even though I don't fear God or care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me.' The Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth?'"
I'm very glad to be here, Kathy and I. Thank you very much for the welcome. We're very grateful for the Vine Church, which is well known and loved around the city. You've seen the title of the talk, which I've planned to give today for a few minutes, which is that according to Jesus, things are better than they seem. So we might pray and ask that God would help this to be a reality for us this morning. So please pray with me. Gracious God, we thank you that you're a speaking God, and we pray that this portion of your word that we consider for a few minutes would be helpful to us and cause us to see you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. It's one of the realities of life that things do sometimes turn out to be better than they seem, so that somebody who seems very unfriendly turns out to be actually very friendly. Symptoms that seem to be sinister, easily explained by your doctor as being nothing serious at all. A job that you have to do, which looks impossible, turns out to be possible. Last night was to be my school reunion. It's 50 years since I left Sydney Boys High. And I was mentally preparing myself to go and meet with some old and battered men who I hardly ever see. And anyway, it turned out to be better than I thought because it was called off because of the COVID. So things turn out to be better than they seem. Now, this short story in Luke 18, which Jesus tells, is designed to show, first, that God is better than you think. The believer is more privileged than you think, and the lines of communication are better than you think. And I think Jesus does a brilliant job in this very short little passage, which I'm not sure if you were listening to when it was read a few minutes ago, but I think he does a brilliant job of setting the record straight about God, because there is so much prejudice against God. We need something in his favor. And of course, many people who represent Jesus Christ are not helping the cause. So we need to go back to what is really true about God. You need also to know that this short story is not what it seems either. So Jesus describes a careless judge. Is he meaning to say, think of God like a careless judge? No, he is not. He describes in this parable a helpless widow. Is he saying, think of the believer as a helpless widow? No, he's not. And then he describes a long process of being ignored. Is he saying, think of prayer like a long process of being ignored? No, he's not. He's saying the opposite. This is a story of contrast, not a story of comparison. Now, Jesus occasionally does this to make the point. He tells another story or parable earlier in the Gospel of Luke about a man who goes to another friend to get some help, but the friend is in bed. It's late. The friend is in bed. The friend won't get up. Is Jesus teaching that if you go to God, it's like going to a friend who's gone to bed? No, he's not teaching that. God doesn't go to bed. And so here is some instruction learning from the opposite. And we learn things by being shown the opposite. If you don't get this, as you read Luke chapter 18, 1 to 8, then you'll really draw some very terrible conclusions. You'll say to yourself, well, maybe God's like a ruthless judge. And maybe I'm like a helpless widow. And maybe prayer is like sort of bashing, bashing, bashing on the door all day. But it's not. So let's think about these three things together. First of all, the truth about God. First of all, God is not a careless judge. He is a very careful judge. Thank God he is a careful judge. But you'll see if you look at Luke chapter 18, verse 6, there is an unjust judge, says Jesus, but verse 7, God is totally different from an unjust judge. The judge in this little parable is reckless. He has no accountability to anyone. He doesn't fear God. He has nobody above him. He just behaves according to his own whims. And he's careless. He has no interest in people. So this poor widow who comes to him doesn't interest him in the slightest. And if you think this is unfair, he says exactly the same about himself in verse 4. He says, I don't fear God and I don't care about people. Now, dear friends, imagine trying to deal with somebody like this. My wife and I have just watched a program about Henry VIII. And Henry VIII, as you know, tried to take all the law into his own hands and tried to take the church into his own hands and tried to take all the power and the kingship into his own hands. And he was a complete erratic liability. Not only that, but this judge won't respond. I have a friend in prison who went in at the age of 14. He's now 16. Sorry, he was converted at 16. He's been in prison for 33 years. And he rang me this week and he said, would you pray for me? He said, because I have written to the Attorney General again and again and again to find out what is my future. And I said, when did you first write to him? And he said, I wrote to him 6 years ago. So he's been sitting in prison for 6 years, writing letters, waiting for one reply from the Attorney General. And I don't know if the Attorney General fears God or cares about prisoners. He may, I don't know. But this guy has had no reply. Now, could people think of God like this? Well, I think people could think of God like this because the evidence without the scriptures is very misleading. The world is sort of falling apart. Friends and family suffer in front of our eyes. Our prayers are often not answered quickly, if at all. So why should we think of God as being consistent or compassionate? And the answer, my friends, is because the evidence is good that he is consistent and compassionate. He's given some promises in the scriptures over the years, over the centuries, and he's kept his promises. And he's also shown incredible compassion, especially in the sending of his son into this world to come and save and die. Now, if the judge in this particular parable had given a promise to the widow, you will be looked after, but you just have to be patient. And if he said to her, I will cover all your fees so you don't have to pay a thing, we might have a better view of the judge. We might actually then say this widow is being a bit of a pest. She just needs to be patient. She's been given a promise. She's been told there'll be no fees. This judge has been very kind to her. She's just not a victim, but a pest. But this judge has done nothing for this particular woman at all. Well, contrast that with God. God has made the world. Watched the world defy him, planned to fix it, sent his son in to fix it, sent his son in to pay the debts which we should pay to him, promised to finish the job, provides consistently for people every day, people who love him and people who don't love him, and he has great compassion on this world. So he's a completely different character from the judge in this parable. And we need the biblical picture of God if we're to have an accurate picture of God. We actually need to go back and see what he says and what he does in order that we might properly respect him. And the clearest picture, of course, we have of God is the historical career of Jesus. When you look at Jesus in the New Testament, you see somebody so attractive that the people in Jesus' day who had absolutely no hope find their hope with him. And the people who oppose Jesus are seen to be completely corrupt and evil in their opposition to him. So I reflect on the attractiveness of Christ. When I was at university, you know, back in the 1870s, there used to be notice boards where you could stick your little advertisement. And a lot of them were for flatmates. I don't know what university students do now. Do they still have public notice boards with notices attached? I suppose it's possible. I'm a technological dinosaur, so I don't know anything about these things. But the notice boards would have flatmate wanted, details, details, details. And then down the bottom, you know what would regularly be put there? No Christians. And I often thought about this, and I thought, I can completely understand why some of the university students would not want a Christian. Because why would you want to bring into your flat, when you plan to do everything that you want to do, why would you bring into your flat somebody who would sit there like a critic, unattractive? You know, we Christians are not great commercials for Christ. But if Jesus Christ came into your flat as your flatmate, I suspect that he would show a kind of a life and a love to you, which would make all your plans, all your silly plans, all your sneaky plans look pathetic. Remember C.S. Lewis once said, you know, he offers us a day at the beach and we insist on playing with the mud in the street. And so I suspect that if Jesus Christ came into somebody's flat, they would either hate him for showing up their weedy plans, or they would be drawn to him and receive more than they ever imagined. When Jesus speaks about this judge, you see, you realize that he's the polar opposite of God. And there's nothing more wonderful than going back to the New Testament and seeing the wonderful and the very observable and checkable qualities of God. That he is consistent, reliable, trustworthy, that he's compassionate, he's aware of people, he's generous, he's thoughtful, he's forgiving. Therefore, don't measure God by your circumstances. That will be a tragedy. Don't measure God by your feelings or your mind. Go back to the promises. And especially measure God by the flag that he stuck into the ground at Calvary, where Jesus died on a cross to say, this is how God loves you. That's how you must measure God. The proof that God does love you and that God will love you is that he did love you. And the way he did love you is the way he does love you and the way he will love you. So there's the truth of God. It's not like the reckless judge. Second, the truth about the believer or the Christian. And believers are not like the widow. The widow has no link to the judge, no access to the judge, no case to persuade the judge. She is completely helpless. And you see how Jesus contrasts the widow and what he calls God's chosen ones. Christians are God's chosen ones. And that doesn't mean when you become a Christian that you were chosen because you were attractive or you were superior or you had great potential or you were worthy or something like that. It simply means that you owe your place in his family to his kindness. So he asks the world, or he calls on the world, to choose him. And when you choose him, you begin to realize that he was active in the process of you choosing. That's how God works. Now, this widow, as I say, belongs to nobody. She's completely helpless. She's not friends with the judge. She has no case to force the judge's hand. He has no interest in listening to her. And so she can only do one thing, and that is to pester him. And so when the judge goes out to lunch and comes back to his office, the PA says to him, "The widow's waiting in your office." And when he picks up his phone, he realizes he's had 7 messages from the widow. When he checks his emails, there's message, message, message from the widow. When he looks at his phone for the texting, there's messages from the widow. When he goes home, there's messages on the answer machine from the widow. In the middle of the night, the door goes and there's the widow standing at the door. She pesters him and she pesters him and she pesters him until finally he gives in. Why does he give in? He gives in out of compassion for himself. He says, "This widow," verse 5, "she's getting to me." Literally, she's getting under my eye. That's what the word says. She's getting under my eye. And the people who comment on the New Testament don't really know what to make of this getting under my eye. And so they say, I think it means that she might punch him under the eye. But I suspect it means that she's giving him dark circles under the eye. In other words, she is exhausting him. And without the news of Jesus Christ, who opens up a place in the family of God for us and gives us access to the Father, you might feel like the widow. Because you might say to yourself, the only way I'm ever getting anything done from God is if I just keep hammering away at his door. And if you don't think I'm telling the truth, just think of the religions of the world where their business of getting some response from God is to drive themselves on treadmills of religion and rituals and spinning wheels and terrible sequences of prayer in order to get the God of the universe or the gods they believe in to take some notice of them. And think also of the way people who are not believers but then fall into desperate times suddenly find themselves praying and wondering why there is this brassy, silent, cold heaven. Because without the message of Jesus to bring you into access with God, into the family, into the throne of God, it really does feel like that. So we're not to go with our feelings when it comes to relating to God, because that'll always let us down. We must go with what God tells us. God tells us that his ear is attentive to the cry of his children. During the week, I was talking to a lady. I think I was talking about myself to her. I think I was speaking at length about myself, which I was finding an absolutely fascinating subject. It was getting more and more interesting the more I spoke. And I just assumed that, like me, she was deeply drawn to what I was saying. But suddenly she just cut me off and she said, "I'm sorry, my baby's crying." And there was a baby in another room and she had picked up the sound, which I had not heard, of this baby. So it is with God. He's attentive to the cry of his people. We may be thinking that we're speaking to nobody when we pray, but the Bible says God is attentive to the cry of what we're saying. Christians, therefore, are not like the widow. We're not helpless. We're not hopeless. This lady, this widow, was unwanted. She was neglected. The Bible says the Christian is wanted and carefully listened to. So when we throw ourselves on Christ, and that's what a Christian is, somebody who has thrown themselves on Christ, we are immediately adopted. And adopted means we have access, like a child to a parent. And it's got nothing to do with performance. We have access on good days and we have access on bad days. We have access on faithful days and we have access on unfaithful days. We have access when we're being godly and we have access when we're being ungodly. because adoption is bigger than performance. I bumped into a lady at the hospital this week, and I know that she and her husband have adopted a couple of kids, and one of them, the boy, is now 15, and he is a nightmare of a kid. He will not go to school. He literally, physically fights his parents. I remember when the parents would come to church with bruises on their arms from the boy who'd been beating them up. And I asked her how things were going, and she said, things are not well. He won't even come out of his room. But she said, he's our boy, and he'll be our boy forever. And that's what adoption is. Nothing like the widow. We're in a very, very wonderful position. The third and last thing is the truth about the open lines of communication, because Jesus teaches that this widow has to bash and bash and bash and bash until finally the guy gives in for his own sake. But it's nothing like that for the believer. The believer has access to the ear and the heart of God according to God's promises, which is absolutely fantastic. I've just finished reading the biography of a guy called David Frost. Some of you may remember David Frost, the British interviewer, TV compere. And he came out to Australia to do some programs, and he stayed with Kerry Packer. And when he turned up on one occasion to stay at the Packer house, they had just run the Melbourne Cup, I think that very day, and David Frost arrived. And Kerry Packer was all excited about this race, the Melbourne Cup that had just been run. He said to David Frost, did you see the race? And he said, no, I didn't see it. No, he said, oh, you missed an incredible race. And he reached for his phone, and he rang Channel 9, and he said, play the race again now. So they just interrupted the program, whatever it was, and they played the Melbourne Cup race because he got through to Channel 9. And Jesus is teaching in this remarkable parable that the believer gets through to God. The widow, obviously, you see, she was bothering the judge, and she had to bother him day and night to get through. But Jesus says in chapter 18, verse 7, the believer who prays any time of the day or the night is immediately heard. We forget this, don't we? It gets over familiar and we don't sort of care so much. But this means that when you're faced with a challenge that you cannot really solve, or you've got some sadness which you're experiencing about somebody or something, or some news comes which is a shock to you, or you're afraid for yourself or for somebody else, or you've got some plans which need divine help, or you've got a task to be done which you're really afraid to tackle, or a thousand different things, and the believer's voice goes up to God, he hears what you say. It does not mean that you will get exactly what you ask, but it means that he will hear, and he'll start the machinery of heaven so that the supplies that are needed will be given. That's the way God works. God the Father, you see, is very powerful, very loving. And we must say to ourselves, he's not like the judge. We're in the position of being adopted children, and we must say to ourselves, we're not like the careless, the helpless widow. The prayers which are offered by God's people are heard and heeded by God, and we must say, we're not like the bashing, bashing, bashing of Luke chapter 18. That's why Jesus tells this parable. It's so that we will pray with gladness and we will pray with some honesty. You might say to yourself, I don't even know what to pray at the moment. And I myself find it difficult sometimes when I go to pray to think, well, what's to be said? Meant to have a time of praying? What should be said? Well, pray the Lord's Prayer and unpack it just a little bit. That'll probably cover most of the bases. Or pick out the prayers of the Apostle Paul in the New Testament and learn what he's praying for people, because they are remarkably shrewd things to be prayed. But you see in this parable, chapter 18, verse 1, Jesus does not want his people to give up or lose heart or lose their way. I suspect this COVID year has polarized people, and so some people have had a faith that has woken I've spoken to many whose faith has taken off this year. But for many people, this COVID year has had an anesthetizing effect. It's almost as though they've just been driven into a kind of a selfish, sad sleep. Some people have begun to look to God for answers. Some people have begun to look everywhere but God for answers. And we must take this truth of Luke chapter 18 and turn it into our prayers, because the great proof of faith is prayer. That's why Jesus says in the last verse, when you meet Jesus, will he find that you are a person of faith? When the Son of Man comes, says Jesus, will he find faith on the earth? That's a very good question. And the answer is he'll find faith shown by prayer, because prayer is the greatest expression of faith. We are going to meet Jesus. There is a great day coming where we will meet Jesus. It's a day of great justice that we should look forward to. It's coming, says Jesus, more quickly than we think. And we need to be people who continue to call to him until the day we meet him. So can I say this to you as I finish, and one or two of you are still with me, which is great. Beware the fog that may descend on you and you begin to reinterpret God in a way that's very different from the scriptures. And he becomes somebody who's very different from the real God, who's consistent and compassionate. And beware the fog that descends so that you interpret your Christian position in a very inferior way to the way the New Testament speaks of it. And beware the fog that lands on you so you begin to think that prayer is no great privilege, where it is a very great privilege. Sometimes Jesus has to teach us by rattling our cage. And earlier in Luke's gospel, he says, you know, do you fathers give scorpions and snakes to your children? Of course you don't. Therefore, if God, who's not evil, knows how to give good gifts, surely he will. So preach Luke 18 to yourself. Say to yourself as you begin the day, or as you go to take a few minutes for prayer, or you think about the challenges that are on your plate, I'm coming to someone who's nothing like a reckless judge. And I myself am nothing like a helpless, isolated widow. And I do not need to bash and bash and bash and bash to get him to listen, because he will listen to my voice in the day or the night immediately. Let's pray. Our gracious God, we thank you for teaching us.
How about that? What did he say? Prayer is a great expression of one's faith. We're blessed to be able to have people like Simon be able to bring and unpack that word for us. A wonderful gift that he has. We're going to have our last song now, and that is A Glorious Day.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they die on suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. Your hands that heal nations, stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. He's living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, and buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day.
That's the end of our gathering meeting this morning. But before I close, just a reminder, there's some of these left if you'd like some. Also, I do hope that you have a great week ahead. And let me close with the grace. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.